In these short lectures, I am going to ask you to think of music historically. But let me say at the outset that by history, I do not mean names and dates. Names and dates are useful labels, but musical history is the record of musical events which happened to real live people. They were musical people, like ourselves, and what they liked were musical thoughts, melodies, rhythms, harmonies, designs. Now, when we study the general history of nations, we have to depend mainly on the descriptions which men wrote of how they felt and acted at various times. In artistic history, we can do much better than this, for the painters have left their paintings for us, the architects have left their buildings, the poets their poems, and we can feel and enjoy these things just as keenly as did the people who first knew them. This is what I want to do with our musical history. I shall talk to you about the circumstances under which many kinds of music have been written, but this would be of little value if you could not hear the music itself. We shall therefore give you on each record examples of the actual music which has stirred or beautified the lives of men in the past. This is the real history of music. Beginnings are always interesting, and the beginnings of music are no exception. We owe a great deal in the character of our music to facts which are often forgotten or lost sight of. For instance, it so happened that our early Christian churches took music under their protection. They probably got many of their ideas and habits of worship from the Hebrew psalms and sacred songs. Not all religions have been musical, but the Christian church has used music from the very beginning. More than this, the church appointed priests and choir masters and choristers whose special duty it was to practice and develop the music of the church. Add to this the growth of all those monasteries and abbeys which in times of great turbulence preserved many of the arts and duties of peace. And you have three quite fundamental causes which affected music throughout the whole of Christendom. Literally for centuries, and in hundreds of churches and abbeys, specially selected musicians were composing and singing the prayers and hymns of the church. In the end, they perfected one of the most beautiful forms of musical expression the world has ever known. At least 1,000 years ago, the art of playing song was fully grown and universally practiced in Christian Europe. It was an art of melody only, and music in a single line. It knows nothing of harmony, nothing of the accent and lilt which came later. But it fixed permanently the intervals and inflections of melody, and nothing more simply, divinely, and expressively beautiful has ever been devised. We shall sing to you the ancient hymn, Vex Illa Regis, one verse in Latin, the original language, and then the same verse in English. There are hundreds of examples of this perfect combination of religious and musical thought. And any true history of European music must begin with this first and fundamental art of playing songs. Our second example is the famous hymn written to celebrate Henry V's victory at Agincourt in 1415. You will notice that the melody is more clearly divided into balanced sections than was the famous song example, and it also has a strange underlying rhythm of 3 beats in a bar. It has begun to follow the meter and the rhyme, so to speak, of verse. Mark how the Latin refrain, Deo gratia, thanks be to God. The composer falls back at once into the plain song's style. We shall sing one verse in unison, then 2 verses with the original descant over the tune. These early descants are the real ancestors of our more modern harmony. Men were trying to write 2 or more melodies that would fit one another. When they succeeded, and it took a long time to find out the way, they had invented a new art, harmony. The early examples were often crude, but this one had real vigor, independence, and expressive force. This descant was written over 500 years ago. So far as I know, it has not been sung in modern times. By singing it now, we are not only studying history, we are actually living it over again. I'm going to go to the hospital.
The composer may have been the monk who made the copy,
Whoever he was, he took this photon and with it constructed an elaborate musical canon. The canon is so designed that two or more parts can sing the same melody, each beginning at some stated interval after the previous one. Here we have a canon in four parts. We shall first sing the melody in unity, then the canon in two parts, then in four. This will make the structure clear. But this is not all. There are two other parts, themselves in canon, making six in all. The canons are perpetual. They will continue to sit forever if the singer did not stop. We shall sing the main canon twice in the final version. Notice that the harmonies are really quite simple, much simpler than the Edging Court Descent in our last record. There are only two chief chords, and they are those of one of the earliest stages. Notice above all that in spite of the extraordinary ingenuity of the composition, there is a freshness and length in the whole texture which seems to align. And one could never guess from the melody itself that it had been so carefully designed. This is the art which conceals art. The Church had laid it down that music should take a high place in its services.
He had also said that only those who were specially trained should have authority over it. And it appointed and supported men who could give practically their whole time to preparing and elaborating the services. When monastic institutions were most influential and widespread, the brethren often spent 7 or 8 hours in a day praying, intoning, or singing the services. The mere number of the different services is remarkable. Matins, Lauds, Prime, Terce, Sext, Nones, Vespers, and Complines were all in daily use. And this does not include the masses and special observances. Men worshipping together so frequently and so intimately could not fail to develop special faculties and special ideas. Psalms, canticles, and hymns were sung so often that it would have been very surprising if the more musically gifted had not tried by every device to vary and elaborate the character and expression of the music. All kinds of musical experiments were tried, some good, some bad. And the chronicles are full of the complaints of conservative spirits against newfangled ways of singing. A new device was blessed or cursed, but nothing could stop the stream of invention. In hundreds of chapels and cathedrals, generation after generation, century after century, men were slowly consolidating a new art. They made every kind of mistake. They were guilty of childish musical puzzles, of absurd ornamentation, of scandalous misuse both of themes and words. But in the long run, and after many quarrels and councils, they found out harmony. And they found it out so surely that ever since it has permeated all our music. It was in the 16th century that harmony finally won its high place. And the men who stand out in this story had two advantages. They were usually attached to a powerful religious order, and their work was international in repute. When Latin is the universal language of the educated church, no man was a foreigner in it, wherever he came from. Thus we find Dunstable, an Englishman, known and accepted as a founder and master of harmony. We find the famous Belgian, who followed him, occupying positions in France and Italy. There were no musical frontiers. We shall see an example taken from the end of this extremely important century. The composer, Jacques Brel, came from Belgium, but he worked mainly in Italy and France. He was the greatest musical genius of his time, and it was he who first wrote with a sure hand those harmonies on which the whole art of Palestrina, of Lassus, and of our own Tudor composers was built. The fragment we shall see is in four parts, beautifully expressive of the words, "The hath his dwelling on high, and yet hath his foot unto the lowly." And the last phrase and final cadence are surely as satisfying as if they had been written today. Harmony precedes its aim. It has become a permanent form of musical thought. There followed this way that great century of which I shall have more to say on the secular side. In order to show what it achieved in church music, I shall ask you to jump 100 years. And listen to a fine six-part setting of the word "Hosanna to the Son of David" by Orlando Gibbons. It is one of the most jubilant pieces of music in existence. And the way its mass of the exclusive sons is built up from the first winning service is both masterless and inspired. The whole effect has been compared to a single verse. Notice the beautiful point of contrast of the world ceased in heaven, and in a new figure of the end. 600 years of effort had gone to the making of such skill and such beauty. And it is good to know that in that art, in that century, English composers had no superior in the whole world.
Thank you.
wonderful work in literature, architecture, painting, and ecclesiastical music. For not without a certain amount of secular music, too, there were trumpets and drums to announce the approach of royalty or the pageant of war or tournament. There were, from the 1st century onwards, the very important guild of minstrels, troubadours, minnesingers, and later the master singers. The famous minstrels of the 12th and 13th centuries were often men of remarkable talent and acknowledged position. They were the friends of kings. They were welcomed in great houses. They travelled with a retinue and received handsome rewards. They were not only poets and musicians, they were also historians and chroniclers. And it is this which explains their high place in society. In those days, when few men could read and few still could write, when apart from the manuscripts of the church and the law, there was practically no written knowledge, it was only by the spoken word of minstrel or preacher that texts could be circulated or ideas discussed. The minstrel would gather the traditions of a great house or the details of a great event, would put them into a ballad and recite or sing them, and by traveling and accumulating a store of such texts, would become chronicler, ambassador, poet, and musician in one. The forms of verse affected the forms of melody, as we have already seen. But the further development of secular music had to wait until the church musicians had discovered and perfected their system of harmony. As soon as the weaving of many voices into one harmony had been accomplished, it spread into every corner of cultured society. At the same time, the various nations of Western Europe were making and developing their own native literature. And it was not long before the world saw a wonderful combination of vocal music and lyric poetry, which produced an amazing festivity of beautiful and permanent work. The movement began in Italy, but it flourished exceedingly in Tudor England. In the England of the late 16th century, nearly every educated person seems to have been either a writer or reader, both of poetry and music. There are hundreds of little poems, most of them of unknown authorship, which were set to music by a whole company of gifted musicians. Scores of collections were printed and published, and this in itself proves how great was the demand for them. Music had in fact come into the ordinary lives of ordinary men. It had come into the home, into the circle of friends, and it shows just that certain intimacy which a few keen friends or relations would naturally have. Our two musical illustrations show simpler features of this domestic vocal music. The first is a little song by John Dowland. Dowland is a singer and a lutenist. The lute, a string instrument plucked to the fingers like a guitar, is very well suited to the simple harmonies which were now universally accepted. To this accompaniment, Dowland wrote his song, setting charming lyrics to equally expressive melodies. He was the first great writer of English songs. They are not the big dramatic movements which came later with the stage and the concert hall. But within the lyrics of his art, there is not a single point, either of the meaning or feeling of the word, which Dowland cannot express in some apt term of phrase or rhythm. These compositions are small in scale, but they are perfect embodiments of an artistic idea, that of giving music and poetry a place together to the educated leisure of ordinary men and women. Our second illustration is a sentiment for two voices by Thomas Morley. Morley takes his little poem and sets it for two parts in just such a way as a few singers might like to have it to their own substance and pleasure. The style of the music is an adaptation of the sacred motif. It is lighter in mood, but it has just those limitations and combinations of melody and rhythm which the church proposes use. Notice how delightfully independent the parts are, how each of them follows its own accent. We have here in simplest form that method of style which reached its highest development in the great magazine. Thank you.
By developing and fixing our system of harmony, they claim to be essentially a discovery. It was the 16th which reaped the reward. Early pioneers are apt to be forgotten, in music as in other spheres. When the music of the Latin Church had reached its culminating point, less mature work was no longer valued. Meanwhile, a social and religious upheaval of the first magnitude was changing Europe. The Protestant Reformation had not only great social consequences, it had great artistic consequences too. One of the most important of these, in England and Germany, was the adoption of plain native speech instead of ecclesiastical Latin. Universal Latin is no doubt convenient to the learned, but it was unintelligible to the common man. England and Germany insisted on translating and using the sacred books in their own tongue. And we have heard of what vigor and effect Gibbon could use this English. But the consequences were wider than this. The acceptance of English as a proper language, even for the most sacred ceremonies, gave a tremendous impetus to the study and use of English in other ways. The story of what happened in England is most interesting. The Tudors gave a strong, permanent, and for the most part, enlightened government. Art and enterprise of all kinds were encouraged. At the same time, the Reformation was popularizing the magnificent English of the sacred books. English became an inexhaustible mine of poetic and dramatic expression. The very struggles with Rome made men turn with even greater fervor to their own native speech and ideas. And just at this time, too, came this new art of musical harmony. Is it any wonder that things were accomplished in music, the combined quality and quantity of which have never been seen either before or since? Drake and Raleigh, Spenser and Shakespeare were no more remarkable than were Thomas Kelly, William Byrd, Orlando Diggins, and a score of other men who, had they come singly, would have seemed each and all to be great masters. These men took the vivid English poetry which then grew in such quality and profusion, and they set it to music for voices, using all that mastery of cultivation which the Church had developed, and using it to extend and beautify secular words and ideas. William Byrd's celebrated preface to his sound, sonnets, and songs ends with the line, "Since singing is so good a thing, I wish all men would learn to sing." They did indeed. Dr. Fellow's great edition of the English Medieval School runs to nearly 40 volumes, all published originally within 20 years or so, around the date 1600. From the hundreds of beautiful medievals, we have chosen two for these records. The first is by John Wilburn, a Jew, Greek Amarillo. The medieval style came from the Philip. The secret of the style is the harmonious interweaving of voice parts, which are each independent, yet melodious and expressive. You will hear the style at its best at the very beginning of this medieval. The parts follow and imitate each other, all perfectly in harmony, yet all independent, and every new sentiment in the world finds a new and musical expression in the music. Nor is there any lack of little rhythmic phrases and chords that could occur in the refrain towards the end, where the composer marks so charmingly the accent of the very middle of French, Amarillo. There are hundreds of languages in which this grace and this sense of beauty find expression. Our second example is a ballad in five parts by Thomas Reed. Here are some of the features of the language I use. The style is lighter and lighter. It has a definite form, divided into two sections, each ending with a parallel line and each repeated. Notice how astonishing the thing is to the rhythm. He takes just what seems to him to be the natural accent and sense of the word, and he gives sometimes three, sometimes four, sometimes six beats to a rhythmic pattern. Every voice part is interesting, and behind all this is the feeling of the drum, the ballad. We cannot say which is my admission in these years. The many could write such masterly music, or the people who had the taste and enthusiasm to demand such quantity of it.
Oh,